Just a quick introduction for Dr. Titley. He's obviously a national known expert in the field of climate, the Arctic, and national security. That's really in his wheelhouse. He served as a naval officer for 32 years and rose to the rank of Rear Admiral. And during that time in his career, his duties included Commander, Naval Meteorology and Oceanography Command, Oceanographer and Navigator of the Navy, and Deputy Assistant Chief of Naval Operations for Information Dominance.
Wow.
If I told you what it was, I'd
have to. I have no idea what that means, but it sounds really cool. He's also served as a senior military assistant for the Director, Net Assessment, and the Office of the Secretary of Defense. While serving in the Pentagon, Dr. Titley initiated and led the U.S. Navy's Task Force on Climate Change. And after retiring from the Navy, Dr. Titley served as Deputy Undersecretary of Commerce for Operations, the Chief Operating Officer position at the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration. Wow. You know, the government, I think you've said this before, they can't do anything with small names. He's right now currently serving on numerous advisory boards, including Citizens Climate Lobby, so we're very happy to have him on our advisory board. He's also a professor in practice in the Department of Meteorology at Penn State University and the founding director of Penn State's Center for Solutions to Weather and Climate Risk. The center helps organizations and citizens prosper and succeed in today's and tomorrow's weather and climate environment by taking advantage of all the skill in weather and climate forecasts. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. David Titley.
And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to first go through really a little bit again of some of the basic science. And some of you have already seen, you know, a tremendous presentation earlier this morning on some. I'll show some different stuff that I found has been kind of effective when I'm talking to non-scientists, smart people, but non-scientists, how to do that. We'll then talk a little bit about some of the more specific implications of climate as it relates to national security and security writ large. And then finally, we'll close with a few, I'll call them, you know, so what's next or what can I do kind of ideas. I don't think there's anything in here that goes against Citizens Climate Lobby, but you already know the mantra from CCL, so I'm not gonna give you that again, but I am gonna give you maybe some other ways to think about this. Okay, so just a little bit of background. You kind of heard already. That's kind of my department, if you will. In the grand scale of departments writ large in universities, it's not all that big, but for a weather department, a lot of weather departments in the country are like one or two or three people. So we're pretty happy with what we have. The center I run is that one in the middle there, and a sister center looks at how do you take all the data and put it into models so you get the right answer there. But we kind of like our tagline there because there are some places like are really, really good at weather, like Oklahoma University, you know, but they got a senator. They can't even talk about climate. And then you've got some other places who are super good at climate, but they don't really do the weather side. And at the end of the day, the two have to meet. And we're very fortunate that we have folks who kind of work both. Okay, so just a little tiny bit about me. We've already talked about the top right. I did not start off wanting to get in climate. I had no idea I was ever going to do climate. I honestly didn't even know I was going to be in the Navy. What I did know from a very, very early age, my mom says at least from kindergarten, maybe nursery school, I've been interested in weather. So I just knew I was going to do weather. And, you know, looking at this is the East Coast. I apologize for that. This is like a setting up for a big snowstorm, and I live for that. I still do. That wasn't me, but it could have been me, because back when I was in school, we were hand-plotting maps and all that kind of stuff, and I can still do that. When I tell my students nowadays, they just roll your eyes. It's like, boy, you're old. But, you know, it didn't seem that way at the time. And I ended up in the Navy, and I would, you know, like to tell you I ended up in the Navy because my great-great-great-great-grandfather was John Paul Jones, but the truth is I needed money. Because I was out of state, and Penn State's expensive, and I needed money. So there was this thing called Navy Reserve Officer Training Course, still is here. And, you know, I was on what I called the four-year-in-a-day program. The obligation was 4 years. I was a great guy. I was going to give the Navy one extra day, and that would be it. But a funny thing happened. It turns out that I actually liked it. I liked driving ships, like big ones. and small ones and everything in between, and the Navy thought I was at least minimally competent, so 4 years and a day turned into 32 years, and you know, sometimes you just never know how life's gonna turn out. So I did that, mostly operational stuff. It was not really climate until the very end, and it was just working on this, but we'll talk about the climate here in a little bit later. So, okay, why do we care? You know, and there's billions of pages of stuff, right? There's a whole IPCC, which is volumes. You know, there's the National Climate Assessment, I'll bet many people here at least have heard of or seen a little bit. You know, that comes into a svelte 1,030 pages. You know, so we probably don't really read that. So one of the things I know, both briefing admirals and ultimately becoming an admiral, is admirals are fairly intelligent, but they're really busy, and collectively we have the attention span of a gnat. So, you know, and then sometimes, you know, like when you're talking to a member of Congress, they're really busy, and if you ever look at their calendar, it's meeting, 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 you know, and it's like boom, 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 all the information. So you probably get this in your training. You know, you've got to be able to kind of like summarize what the gist of it is. So here's what this is just my personal thoughts, but this is why I care about climate, why we care. People. This is fundamentally a people issue. It is not about polar bears or polar bear plunges. I have no life. So one Saturday night, I typed into Google climate change, but click on images. Don't look at all the links. Click on images. And I counted them because I have no life. And about a third of them are Arctic or polar bear related. It is the visual image. But we've heard earlier today in some other sessions, you know, how many polar bears naturally wander around Central Texas or Mississippi or Alabama? It's distant. It's like, so what? I mean, honestly, most people, you know, maybe there's at some point it's like, yes, it's bad for the polar bear, and I sort of feel bad for him, but is it going to directly impact you or your family? Probably not. And I would argue that the environmentalists, best of intentions, but they kind of locked onto a message that was hard to get people to feel personally connected. Most people. Some are very passionate about it, but most people it's hard. But I tell people it's not about the polar bears. It's about us. It's about you, it's about me, it's about our families, it's about our children, it's about our parents, it's about our neighbors, our people in our towns and our villages and our cities. It's really about us, because that's who's going to get impacted and affected by the changing climate. My second point is if you want an integrating principle, water's a pretty good one. Heat is also, it's not bad, but I kind of like water because it brings in what, on the face of it, looks like a whole bunch of very disconnected and independent things, and it kind of integrates it. And I like things that you can kind of sum up and integrate. I look at the water, and you know what we're going to have is too much, too little, wrong place, wrong time. I mean, I think we've seen this in Texas. We've seen this in many other parts. You know, drought, drought, drought. And then when it rains harder than we've ever seen it before. And you get a massive, massive flooding issue. Too much, too little, wrong place, wrong time. The water is salty where it used to be fresh. Go talk to the people in South Florida. Go talk to the people on the California coast. As the seas rise, it's actually pushing salt water into the aquifers. You know, you talk about sea level rise, and not everybody realizes that long before you're physically flooded out of your house, if you don't have any fresh water, it's going to be pretty tough to make it there. So salty where it used to be fresh, wet where it used to be dry, again, that sea level rise, liquid where it used to be frozen, both on the ice, of the sea ice in the Arctic, but also increasingly now we're seeing on the big land ice. The glaciers are melting back, even the ice fields are melting back, West Antarctic ice sheet, Greenland. So the water itself is changing, and this is changing, you know, the long-term threats from sea level rise are going to be in the trillions of dollars for us to deal with. Not today, not this week, not next year, but those long-term effects are trillions if we don't get this under control. And then change. You know, I mean, this is just without belaboring the point, but, you know, the weather in very few places in the world is perfect. Now, there's probably somebody here from San Diego or Hawaii, or you used to live there. It's pretty darn close to perfect in those areas. I'm in the middle of Pennsylvania. We don't see the sun between about October and March because it's winter and it's gray. But we've known what it's going to be, and the farmers know what it's going to be. And we know where to put our cities because the sea level is stable. So the change part of climate change worries me more than the climate piece. If the change is slow, people can adapt. Ecosystems adapt. Animals and critters adapt. If the change is fast, and fast relative to those terms, then it becomes a very bumpy and worst case, a catastrophic ride. So it's the change part. So people, water, change. If you remember that, actually, I'm happy. It's people, it's water, it's change. That's why we care about this. Okay, we've all heard, I'm sure you all know, and you've all seen, because it is true, and although sometimes this is a talking point by folks who don't really want to do much with the climate challenge, it's always changed, right? We've all heard that climate has changed. It's true. It's absolutely true. This is a 500,000-year scale, though. This is a really long time. And what we're really seeing is the ice ages, and the ice ages is caused because of changes, the way the Earth goes around the sun and how we get tipped on our axis around the sun. It changes how much heat comes in. And actually, if you think about it, the changes aren't huge, but just little changes in how much heat comes in has really big changes on our climate. So then, you know, sometimes you hear, well, geez, mankind couldn't possibly do this, it's so big. Well, this kind of shows a natural change that isn't that big, but has really big effects. You know, so, you know, pick your graph there. You know, let's just take the bottom one. That's the sea level going up and down by hundreds of feet. But then when you zoom in just to the very, very right-hand side of that, so this is like, you know, 6, 8, 10,000 years ago, what we see is stability. It's sort of the Goldilocks period. The temperature's basically stable. The sea level rise basically stable. So, you know, people, Homo sapiens has been around for what? Tens, hundreds of thousands of years, right? I mean, most people think that. And we won't, that's a different discussion for a different day. But let's accept that people have been around for a long, long time. But when did civilization get created? It's only about 8, 10,000 years ago. You know, we weren't chasing the climate or being chased by the climate. We could find that if we grew wheat or barley, it would grow in the same place. If we put a port in some place, we didn't keep getting chased around. So we have literally built human civilization on this concept of climate stability. We didn't really realize it. We didn't say, oh, great, you know, we've got climate stability, let's build civilization. But it's happened that way. And now we've got, what, 8 billion, give or take, people that have relied on this, and now we're changing it. And that's the crux of the issue. So everything else I talk about is kind of details. But people, water, change. You know, we had it really good. If we didn't mess about with it, we'd still have it good for another 10 or 20,000 years, but we're changing it. And now we're going to have to do something about it. So that's kind of the bottom line message. Okay, so I mentioned in the Navy, I wasn't really looking at, you know, climate per se and all that kind of stuff. But one of the coolest jobs I had, my first job actually, I got to be a navigator. Any idea what this thing is here? Sextant. Yeah, some people know this. When I go talk to college kids, they have no idea. They don't even realize that there used to be a time when you were at the ocean, you did not just punch a button and it would tell you to within, you know, 15 feet of exactly where you were. You know, so one of the things you learn being a navigator, at least back then, and I think it's still true, is you look at all the data, but you don't lock on or don't believe any one piece of data 100%. And I found when I was asked by the head of the Navy to say, hey, go take a look at this stuff and see if we should deal with it, I said, okay, I'm just going to go in and say, let's see what the data tell me. What does the weight of evidence tell me? That's how I navigated and didn't get fired from that. I figured it would kind of work. And it's a weight of evidence thing. So, you know, there are, you know, if you can find multiple independent lines of evidence that all sort of point to the same thing, then, and you have a theory, if there's some physics behind that, that's pretty powerful. So let's see what we can see here. We'll just kind of zorch through a couple of these. So I'm going to start with one you may or may not have seen. Reinsurance companies, people know what they are? Yeah, I'm seeing a lot of head nods. Yeah, these are the guys who insure the insurance companies. So bottom line is they got big money, like tens of billions or a little bit more sometimes on the line because they're insuring insurance companies. And guys like Munich Re, like General Re, like Swiss Re, they say, hey, this climate thing, is it real or not? Without presupposing one way or the other. So they said, you know, I'm going to count the disasters. Just count them. And without getting into the details, but the green, the orange, and the blue on there are weathering climate-related disasters. Not how much money, not billion-dollar disasters, because all that stuff gets into, well, how wealthy we are, where people are living. This is, hey, did it happen on the world? This isn't just the U.S., but on the world, did it happen? Because some people will say, well, yeah, there's more, but that's because we have more people, right? Or we're wealthier. Have you heard that argument? I've heard it. The counterargument that I like on this graph, you see that red down at the bottom? What's the trend? What do you think the trend is? Yeah, I'd say there's no trend. You know, I mean, I haven't done the exact statistics, but I'm pretty darn sure there's no trend. That's the geophysical. That's earthquakes and tsunamis and tidal waves, you know, stuff like that, volcanoes. You know, so yes, we're counting, and we don't see, you know, despite more people and where we live and all that. So that tells me that, you know, these guys at Munich Re, they were probably counting fair. Because otherwise, you know, that number, if it was related to people, would have been coming up too. So, you know, there's one data point, you know, but you can say, well, yeah, those insurance guys, I'm not sure if I trust them. Okay, that's fine. So here we go. Let's go. I got this in Norfolk, Virginia. So I do a bunch of work. Biggest naval base in the U.S., actually biggest naval base in the world is in Norfolk. I call it recurrent flooding because in the state of Virginia, you can't talk about sea level rise. So in deference to my good friends in Richmond, Virginia, I call it recurrent flooding instead. You can talk about that. This is ours. This is kind of a weird chart. On the left-hand side, that vertical axis, this is ours. Ours per year. Starting in 1920, almost 100 years ago, and going till very recently, this is a neighborhood. It's not the Netherlands, but it's a neighborhood right downtown. And it's how many hours every year they're underwater. And you can see those big spikes, those are like big storms, nor'easters, hurricanes, whatever. But I would argue there's probably a trend going on there. And it's accelerating. You know, I mean, I don't know. But it looks to me like something's going on. It looks like the seas are coming up. And both the seas are coming up and the land is going down a little bit. And that's what you've got. So there's another data point. And it's like, well, yeah, that's two. So some of you have probably seen this. I like, this comes courtesy of NASA. And if it runs, which I think it will, there we go. Just watch this, and I'll run it a couple times. Here's the year, right there, right to the left of the scale. And the colors are based on the long-term 20th century average. So blues are colder than the long-term 20th century. Oranges are warmer. Watch the Dust Bowl right here, 36, 37. You know, the U.S. kind of lights up in an orange, right? But a lot of places, it was white or it was blue. So we'll go up to the 60s. Here we are. Who can remember the 60s? Okay, you weren't there then, right? Okay. 70s. 80s. Just watch it. You know, you pick a place, maybe pick where your great-great-grandparents came from. 2000, we made it through Y2K. 2009, and I was gonna give the last 2 years, but it screwed up my PowerPoint thing, so I'll fix it later. But in 2014, 2015, there's even more red. So again, you can see, you know, if you live in one particular place, it may not be a record, it may not even be above the average, but more and more of the world is getting hotter and hotter. This is not a computer projection. This is not what somebody thinks might happen. This is just take all the thermometers in the world and average them up. That's what this is. It's pretty simple. Run it one more time? I'll run it one more time. It's kind of cool. There we go. Okay. So again, you know, just pick a place to watch or watch the patterns. Watch whatever you want. 1900.
Did you say again what the base year was?
The base is actually taking the average between 1900 and 2000. Add up those 100 years, divide it out, and that would be white for all of the different, you know, it's going to be obviously a different color for every location on that graph, but white is the long-term 20th century average. The question was, what do the colors mean? So here's the 60s, 70s,
And again, this is not somebody thinks might happen. This is just what we've observed. 80s, 90s, you know, up and down, but kind of in that staircase ever, ever upwards. So up to 2012. And as I said, if I had 13, 14, and 15, and I'll try to fix the slides up, but it's going to look more like that. Okay. So here's, you know, just another way. This does include 2015. That bar on the very top right, that's 2015. And when you overlay what our CO2 levels are, kind of interesting, you know, just saying. You know, kind of interesting there. So, you know, here's one that's kind of a new graph. Actually, I just pulled it, I think, about a week or two. This comes from my friends at Columbia. And, you know, we hear right now, of course, we're in a big El Nino. And people say, well, of course it was hot. It was a big El Nino. And, yeah, the El Nino certainly contributes. But the last two big El Ninos, the green one is in the early 80s, 82, 83, and then the 97, 98. A lot of people remember that. And you can see the red is where we are now. So yes, El Ninos are coming in, but think of it like on a rising tide. So think of the El Nino as kind of a big wave, but they're coming in ever, ever higher. You know, my guess is the next big El Nino, let's say it's 2020 or 2022, it'll be higher still, because it's the combination of these natural ups and downs with the El Ninos and things like that on top of what we are doing by putting the greenhouse gases in. So the question is, in case people couldn't hear it, will El Ninos become on a more frequent basis? And will they be bigger? I think that's an open question. What I'm saying is, whenever the next big one is, it'll probably be higher than we are here, because it's going to come in on a higher base because of more man-made greenhouse warming. So each one keeps on coming in a little bit higher. The frequency, not to make this an El Nino discussion, but it is not like clockwork. It's not like the tides or the sun. And there are sometimes you can get two pretty big ones close together, and other times then you'll go like 12, 13, 14 years. Okay, so the question is do I believe in climate change? Not just believe, I mean, do I believe? Okay, so show of hands, who believes here in climate change? Okay, I don't. I know, cheap rhetorical trick. I don't. I'm convinced by the evidence, but I would argue that belief systems are things that we might do maybe on a Friday night or a Saturday night or a Sunday morning. Those are belief systems. They fundamentally cannot really be proven one way or the other. I am convinced that there are multiple lines of independent evidence based on very well-established physical theory that the climate is changing. But, you know, I get asked all the time, do I believe in this? This is not a religion. This is just science. That's all it is. It's just physics. Nothing more, nothing less. So I don't believe, but I'm fully convinced by the evidence that it is changing. However, not everybody does believe in this. And if you want, at the end, if we have some time, I've got about 3 minutes with me and the good Senator Cruz from last month, and we can play that if you want. Who would want to see that? Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is what passes for entertainment in Washington, D.C.
You took a moment to address what you described as the so-called pause.
I baited him in my
global
written
temperatures. By the pause, are you referring to the last 18 years of no significant recorded warming?
Well, unlike your previous witness, I am not referring to the 1940s. I thought you'd like that.
Indeed,
yes.
It's an inside joke, but I can explain it later.
As you know, sir, 1998, big El Nino. So it's kind of interesting we started 18 years. We don't look at a 15-year data set or a 10-year data set or a 20-year data set. We look at an 18-year data set. But even if you do that, that's fine. Let's look at that. This is low budget here. I got to do my own charts. Thanks, Amanda.
Well, let me take a moment.
Sir, just to answer your question, Senator, here was 1998, and here's today.
So on me, I mean, I'm just a simple sailor, but it's hard for me to see the pause on that chart. So I think the pause is kind of...
Do you dispute the satellite measure?
That's enough. Yeah, we could talk more about the satellite stuff. But anyway,
that's what I'm asking you. I understand that the global warming alarmists don't want to talk about it.
Okay. Do not underestimate Senator Cruz. He is an exceptionally smart gentleman and an exceptionally skilled debater. Although he... you know, says he's an outsider, take a look at his pedigree. He is a very, very sharp person. So it's interesting trying to talk about that. Anyways, we'll keep going, and happy to, in Q&A, if we have some time, I'm happy to talk more about that hearing. But here's, you know, one of the questions is, okay, you climate guys, you climate scientists, so if you're so darn good, can you actually tell us what's going on? And a lot of people say, oh, the models are useless, right? So I went back, and if this looks like a Xerox of a PDF of a Xerox of a PDF, it's because it kind of is. It came out of a journal called Nature from 1980, and a guy named Jim Hansen, the climate guy, not the Muppets guy, he basically ran a model that we could all now run today on our cell phones. I mean, that's how simple it was computing power-wise, although it was a supercomputer back then. And the black line is what he came up with, starting in basically 1980. So, you know, 35 years have gone by, so how'd the guy do? So, long story short, that smooth, really thick purple line, that's what he did. So technically, he was actually a little bit wrong. He was too cold. And there's a saying in the science community, and probably others as well, that all models are wrong, but some are useful. I would argue that was useful because it said, we're gonna get on this escalator and we're gonna start going up. Turns out we went up a little bit faster than Hansen was thinking. That was 35 years ago. So it's like, okay. You know, you also hear from a number of people, it's like all these IPCC models, they haven't got anything right. You hear that a fair amount. So again, well, let's see. Let's just see. So these are all the ones that were run in the year 2000, or up for the year 2000. They're actually run in the late 90s. So again, we've got about 15 years. And the black line, without making this too complicated, the black line is what we've actually observed. That big gray area, that's like if you take all of these, and there are dozens and dozens of these things, that's the what they call the 95% confidence level. Basically, you can be pretty sure that we don't know the exact answer, but it's somewhere in that gray line. And it turns out that probably the half dozen most reputable models are plotted on there. And you can see, that ain't bad for a 16-year forecast. So are they perfect? No. Will a model ever be perfect? No. Do they tell us a lot? Yes. I mean, that's kind of hopefully the takeaway from that. Okay, well, that's all government stuff, and we know we can't trust the government, right? So, okay, fine. It turns out, though, that our friends at, then ESSO, now ExxonMobil, their scientists came up with the exact same thing back in 1980. Exact, basically same thing as what Hansen was coming up with. They elected not to publish their results, but they knew it. So I tell my friends that, you know, the industry, smart people in industry, had the exact same thing. And, you know, and why is that? It's like, well, it's just physics. That's just the radiative transfer equation. It's not that hard. Really, it's not that hard. It's just physics. And not only is it physics, but I tell people it's physics that was figured out by a bunch of old dead white guys. So you got Fourier on the left, you got Tyndall in the middle, and you got Arnhus, a Swede, on the right. So you have a Frenchman, a Scot, a Swede. They do not go into a bar as far as I know. But by the time you get Fourier, basically in 1842, figured out the basic molecular properties of why it is that carbon dioxide can re-radiate the heat. And by the time you got to Arnhus, the Swede, he said, hey, this is 1906. We've had this Industrial Revolution thing going on for like 100 years. And he starts actually calculating what the global warming is. Turns out he underestimated how much greenhouse gas we'd be putting in. But he was basically on the right idea. So we've known this stuff for a long, long time. Do we know everything? Of course not. And we could spend a whole afternoon talking about all the cool things that we need to figure out still. But the basics are very, very, very well known and understood and accepted. So don't let people, you know, kind of like try to knock you off that message, because they're incorrect. Okay.
Let's gonna step down here one level and let's talk about climate change on national security. And again, because I don't have the attention span of a gnat, I have to put it on one slide and three things. It's all I can remember. So the risks are accelerating. When I say risk, I mean the probability of an event times a consequence. That's a risk to me. So what we have seen is that the chances of these significant climate disruptions happening are greater. And we're seeing by things like the Arab Spring, by ISIS, not that they're caused by climate, but climate is one of the links in the chain that we're seeing these risks becoming very real. It's a catalyst for conflict. Does anybody here remember the old BASF commercials? You know, we don't make things, we make things better. A few people remember them. I say climate, it's like we don't make things, but we make it worse. Sort of the anti-BASF. So climate many times won't be the reason, but when you add it with bad governance, existing ethnic tensions, resource competition and conflict, let's say they were just getting by, and then you all of a sudden dry out all the water or you take away all the crops because of really bad drought, that becomes a catalyst. And the ones that scare me the most are honestly the ones that we haven't thought about. It's that failure of imagination thing. This is a graph or a similar graph. I didn't have the colors on it, but I gave to the heads of about 70 of the world's navies. I was asked by the head of the US Navy to come and give a talk, and he had all his friends there. Really four things, and the colors don't come out quite right on this. But Arctic, the Arctic is opening up, and I'll talk about that very quickly. The impacts to bases, not only naval bases, but really military bases around. I had a great conversation not too long ago with the U.S. Army commander of Alaska, and the thing that's really messing them up there, forest fires. Not because they're being told to go fight the forest fires, but you get so much soot in the air, you can't breathe. It impacts the training of the troops. It impacts the visibility. You can't go and do all your stuff. And the way the U.S. works is you generate ready soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines at our bases, and then they go overseas to go do whatever it is the president wants them to go do. That's what we've done really for the last 100-plus years in America. We don't want to fight at home. We want to fight the away game if we have to fight. So we got to generate readiness and make sure that people can do that, and the bases are getting messed up, and it's not just the sea level. For the Navy, you know, we kind of put our ships at sea level. I tell people it's a Navy thing. Ships belong at sea. So, you know, we are not going to move the big Navy base to Austin, Texas, or Minot, North Dakota. We're just not going to. So we got to deal with that. Disaster relief, that's what people think of. You know, big typhoon comes through. I'm not going to talk about that much because, honestly, you see that all the time. And then these security threats. We'll talk just a little bit about that. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the Arctic. And here's another animation. This one, not from NASA, but from my friends at NOAA. So let me just orient you here. Here's the year going across here, and the months are going underneath that. The other cool thing is that you get the age and the thickness of the sea ice. White is really thick, blue is really thin, and you can see the gradations. Just like that last animation I showed you, this is not a computer projection. This is just taking reality. This is taking what the satellites have seen, and thank goodness we have satellites that can see through clouds and see through night, because otherwise this would be a pretty boring image, because there's a lot of clouds and a lot of night up there. So watch what happens on this animation when you get to like 2007. So, and it's really cool if you're a science geek like me, just watching all the circulations, it's like just totally cool. 07, boom, where'd the ice go? Tries to come back in 08 and 09, like my portfolio tried to. And then 12, boom, even lower. So what you've seen, ladies and gents, is a change in the Arctic in roughly 10 to 15 years. Nobody thought would happen in a space of, let's say, less than half a century or a century. So, you know, when sometimes we'll hear people, it's like, oh, those climate people, they're these wild-eyed, crazy, radical scientists, you know, probably have Birkenstocks and ponytails or whatever. If we're wrong because we're too conservative. It almost gets back to that failure of imagination part. Where we have been wrong, we have been underestimating the rate and the magnitude
of change. Science is, in fact, inherently conservative. So we tend to miss on the low side. And that's what happened here in the Arctic. Okay. In the interest of time, we won't spend a lot on this, but it is changing. I hope you see that it's changing faster than any place else in the world. When I say it's not a vacuum, I mean the Arctic is not like Vegas. What happens in the Arctic does not stay in the Arctic. That means both for the weather, there is some evidence, it's not conclusive, but there's some evidence that the changes in the ice are actually changing the weather even as far down as here in Texas and in the Midwest and in the East. Politically, that's also true. What happens with Russia in Crimea and the Ukraine gets reflected in how they build up their military and their security in the Arctic. And again, that could be like another whole session for another day. And we in the U.S. need to get ready there. So we've got to be able to do that. Okay, this comes out of the U.S. Navy's revised Arctic roadmap. I'm very happy to say I was able to put the first one out in 2009, and then 5 years later, as we said we would. Who's being part of a big corporation? Okay, most of us. So, you say living document, right? That means nobody's really ever going to look at it again. We know that. Okay, and you say, oh, yes, this document will be reviewed in, and you put a year. How many times does that really happen? Right. Don't pin me down on that one. So we said in 2009 that we were going to review this in 5 years, and by God, the Navy actually did it. I wasn't even around to do it, but the Navy actually did it. I was pretty happy about that. So what this is showing, okay, bureaucracy aside, North Pole right in the center, right where it says North Pole. So Canada on the left, Russia on the right, Bering Strait between Alaska and Russia, right up at the very top, and Iceland's at the 6 o'clock position. So that's the orientation. That blue line there, that's the Northwest Passage. Who's heard of the Northwest Passage? Everybody, right? Okay. That is a lot of talk about it, but honestly, there just will never be a ton of shipping going through there. Even if you get rid of all the ice, because it's shallow relative to today's big modern ocean-going ships, and it's a tough navigation detail. You got to make a bunch of pretty hard turns, with big ships, possibly some ice around, not great charts. It's dangerous. So my guess is we're never going to see a lot of shipping through there. The ones the Russians are pushing hard is that red line. They call it the Northern Sea Route, and in relative terms, it's grown a lot. It's from a few ships maybe 7 or 8 years ago to now several dozen. But just for scale, there are 18,000 ships every year going through the Suez Canal. So several dozen, 18,000. So yes, it's grown in percentage terms, but in absolute terms, there's still not a ton of traffic. The wild card is that green line. And this is like this over-the-top, over-the-North-Pole route. And more people are thinking that opens up seasonally, maybe in the 2020s. And if you do that, it's deep water, you don't need Russian permission. People like the Finns are actually putting millions of dollars in research and development to develop a cargo ship that could basically go from, let's say, Dutch Harbor in the Aleutian Islands to Iceland as a shuttle service across the top of the world. That starts changing shipping in a very, very big way. And as we all know, shipping, that is the logistics of today. They are the warehouses of today, are those container ships. So this could really, really change the Arctic. Is it going to happen? We don't know. There are also smart people who say it's never going to happen. But there's a bunch of smart people who say, watch out. So if you're in the Navy and managing risk, you got to say, hey, we should at least think about it, because there are a number of smart people who say this is going to happen. Okay. There's also, I was up at a place called Svalbard. I don't know if anybody's been up there or not. It is an island way north of Norway that is Norwegian mostly. There's a weird treaty that kind of mostly gives it to Norway, but not quite. It's off of the coast of Greenland. It's way up there. It's at 80 degrees north. This is not out of episode 2 of Star Wars, but actually it is a place where it's so far north you can control every satellite in what they call a polar orbit, a north-south orbit. Every orbit, it'll see it. It's a great place to control satellites. Space is kind of the strategic high ground now, and these are the guys that can control it. So there's a lot of other things they can do at Svalbard. That's up in the Arctic. It's owned by Norway, but the Russians push on it. So again, from a security point of view, this is what I worry about. I don't worry about the border dispute between the Yukon Territory of Canada and Alaska. We are not going to go fight anybody over that. this one here with the Russians doing what the Russians have done in the last couple years, push, 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 find the seams. The Norwegians, a little concerned about this, and we should at least pay attention. Okay, we'll talk about bases. I've talked a little bit about this, and you know, we always think of Bangladesh. This came out of, I didn't go to Paris, but I did go to Copenhagen. That was fun. And you know, Tuvalu for about 4 days were the rock stars of that conference. And we think about these small island nations or very low-lying countries, and those are huge issues. Anyone have any idea where this place is, though? Diego Garcia. You may have never heard of it. Most important island you've never heard of. It's British. It's just south of the equator in the middle of the Indian Ocean. And every significant Department of Defense military operation that's dealt with the Middle East or the Persian Gulf area has had logistics and combat forces staged out of here. The Brits let us do whatever we want as long as we're nice to the birds and the turtles. So we're nice to the birds and the turtles. It's about a meter and a half above sea level on a good day. And if we do not have access to this because of sea level rise, the DOD has to basically fundamentally think how we would do operations in a very, very important part of the world. So that's a piece of a security issue from climate that we don't always think about. And then, of course, there's a domestic issue, and this is not how much the waters are gonna rise, but how many people are gonna get affected just by a little bit of change. Red is bad, and you can see if anybody, who works real estate in here? Oh, somebody's got to. But if anybody knows how to like short South Florida real estate market, let me know. I mean, they've got some challenges. And right now, they're kind of in denial. So it's going to be interesting, seriously, going to be interesting to watch that. They're, not to get too far into the details, but it's all on limestone. So you can build the biggest levee, like New Orleans or the Dutch in the world. The water's going to say, "Ha, it's limestone. I'm just going to come underneath it." So, that's an issue. So that's going to be an issue. The good thing is irrespective of the national politics and even the state politics, at the regional level, liberal, conservative, Republican, Democrat, they know they've got a problem at the county and regional level, and they're trying to figure out what to do. And that's, at least they've got to step one. They know they've got to do something. Okay, we'll talk, as I said, I'm not going to talk about the disaster relief in the interest of time, but this, some of these security threats. And I'm going to go through this just a little bit because it's important, and we've heard a lot of things. And this came up in the Democratic presidential debates by Senator Sanders, and he basically said that climate change caused ISIS. With all due respect to Senator Sanders, I would actually push back on that pretty hard. Climate was one of the links in a very complex chain that got us to this horrific situation of ISIS and the extremists in that part of the world. You know, you can pretty easily trace it back 45 years, back to about when Assad took over Syria. One of the things he said he was going to do is, we're going to make Syria self-sufficient in food. Well, it's a semi-desert anyways. It's like, is that the smartest thing? Whatever. That's what he did. But what, in doing so, he drained a lot of the rivers and a lot of the very long-term underground water. So fast forward, you know, some things nothing to do with climate change also happened, like the Iraq War. Put a million refugees into Syria, into the cities, a million people. This is Syria. They can't really handle that. You know, and then fast forward further, and as many different climate models have projected, it's got hotter and drier, so that they're seeing some of the worst droughts that we've ever seen out there. But they used up the bank account, right? They used up the rivers, they used up the underground water, they've got a ton of additional foreign people in their cities, and now they can grow nothing. It's dust. It's just dust. So now 750,000 farmers, basically internally displaced people, go into the cities. It's Assad. It's not like he's taking care of anybody, and it breaks. And it breaks catastrophically. It's a breeding ground for extremism, and ultimately one of the things you get out of that is ISIS. So does that make sense? You see how climate is one of the things, but it's far too simplistic to say climate caused it. It's equally, I think, in my personal opinion, wrong to say climate had nothing to do with this. And I know I was asked at the hearing by Senator Cruz, it's like, well, should we deal with ISIS or should we deal with climate? You know, and it's a false choice. And, you know, superpowers and powers like the U.S., You need to deal with the problems that you have today, but you also have an obligation to work on those root causes and make sure that tomorrow is better. And that's the climate part. So you know, no responsible person is saying we should ignore the terrorist threat. But at the same time, that is not a reason to not do anything on climate. Does that make sense? Arab Spring, similar kind of thing. What you had, this is a commodity price index. And you know, if you pay attention, or not pay attention, but if you see, like 2010, 2011, you see that really big shoot up. It turns out that North Africa, I'll bet people here know way more about this than I do, but North Africa is actually like one of the biggest wheat importing regions in the world. You know, bread is just a very, very critical part of the diet. Not a ton of disposable income, so budgets are pretty tight. And when things almost double, that puts real pressure on. One of the reasons it doubled, one of the reasons, is big droughts in Russia, Ukraine, and Australia. Remember those crazy forest fires? We all saw the dash cams? That was the year. So the harvest failed. Australia had a really, really hot summer, and it had a lot of pressure on them as well. And again, a bunch of countries that maybe are not the best at taking care of their people, so this then just kind of exacerbates or explodes attention. You know, so it doesn't mean that every drought in the corner of the world is going to turn into an Arab Spring, but I would say, let's say the drought in California, that's sort of like taking a match and throwing it on diesel. What happens when you do that? Match goes out. Diesel doesn't burn as a liquid like that. Throw match on a pile of gasoline vapors, boom. And so again, it's understanding the impacts of climate. In this case, it was climate from literally half a world away, how it impacted North Africa there. Okay. You know, just a couple of the challenges. You know, irrespective of climate, the U.S. Department of Agriculture says in the next 50 years, we need to grow more calories than we have in the last 500, irrespective of climate. I've got a picture, not because we're going to do a little video of Finding Nemo here, but one of the sort of unsung challenges of climate is almost half of the CO2 gets actually absorbed or taken up by the oceans. In the process, though, it actually changes the actual chemistry of the ocean, and it makes it more acidic. And that has potential to disrupt the food chain. The exact ways are still being studied. And is this going to be a, yeah, kind of, that's not good, but we can survive? Or is it catastrophic? We don't know. We honestly don't know. But what we do know is 2 billion people get their primary protein from the ocean. So if they can't get that, and you already have that graph on the top left, and you're going to a hotter world with less regular precipitation, you know, that's a risk. That's why we say climate is a risk to security. This is what it's about. Okay, we've got 10-ish minutes, and what can we do? I like Janice here because it's so easy to look back. Like when you plan things, you just take the last 100 years and you say, well, okay, that's what it's going to be. It's harder to look forward, but that's what we now have to do. Okay, one of the things, and CCL is a perfect example of this. This is about the only slide I still use from when I was in the Navy and I talked about this. This was my slide from my task force climate change. And everybody thinks, oh, you're an admiral, you're in the Navy. So, you know, show of hands, how many people, you know, worked for me when I was doing that? Thousands, right? Must have been. It's like, no, it was two and one was half time. So, because I was told to go do this, but of course, like any good business, you're not actually given any resources to go do it. So that's okay. So I took my smartest captain and my best civilian and said, guess what you're now doing as of Monday? And you know, when the boss is interested, what are you? Fascinated. They were fascinated. So that was good. But what we did is so fine. I had two people who worked for me on this. But we had, you can see the numbers here, almost 500 and over 100 organizations. And I think CCL really does this as well. What I've heard and seen is you partner, you know, be it with regional, with local, with federal, with other organizations. You know, we were just with R Street yesterday, you know, so that's a partnership. And I think that's incredibly important in this field. There are lots of technical solutions, and you probably all know more about the technical aspects of carbon fee and dividends. There's risk management. There's better near-term forecast. How do we bridge that gap between weather and climate? There are things like Old Dominion and Norfolk are doing to try to put teams together to battle the sea level challenge there. And again, we can talk as much or a little about those, but you know, I want to talk about, I'll talk about sort of some of the root sort of causes, just what I see. So when I look at energy and electricity in the US, roughly 3/4 is carbon-based and roughly 1/4 is not. So the not is nuclear, it's hydro, it's wind, it's solar. That's the non-carbon part. So if we just kind of let things go as they're going now, it gets better, but by 2040, it's still 2/3 carbon, 1/3 non-carbon. You know, so the challenge is going to be not that we aren't converting, because we are. The challenge is going to be, how do you make those lines towards the right of the graph go down faster and you fill in the renewables faster? You phase out coal, you phase out the other carbons faster, and you put the non-carbons in. That's really what we have. I told somebody at lunchtime there, you know, there's a saying in the Navy, specifically in naval aviation, the two things that are really of no use to you if you're flying an airplane, altitude above you or runway behind you. Think of that the next time you're on United and you seem to be getting towards the end of the runway. But we're kind of like, we put a lot of runway behind us on this. And I know you guys know that, you know, and I feel the urgency in CCL. But we've got to be able to sharpen those curves on the right to get ourselves faster over. So, you know, I apologize, but I'm more of a creature of DC than any place else. I've spent too much time up there. And one of my little sayings is, you know, you are your budget. So if you just bear with me here, this is how much money in billions of R&D is research and development that the United States has spent really for the last half century, not the defense stuff. And it's color-coded by sort of what have we spent it on. So, you know, President Kennedy says, go to the moon. Boom, look at the yellow. You know, and in today's money, that was about 40 to 50 billion a year in today's money that we put in there. We got to the moon, that money came down. That makes sense. You can even see where that green goes up in the 70s. That was the oil crisis. Some of you remember, there are some people who have no idea what I'm talking about. But there was an oil crisis back in the 70s. And the president, President Nixon said, hey, we got to do stuff. Now, a lot of that was not renewables, but it was, you know, what are we going to do? If you look back the last 10 to 15 years on this, I would challenge you to see, if I was a Martian who just landed and said, take me to your non-defense R&D portfolio, I don't know why I'd say that, but if you did, there's nothing on there if I came in from another planet and said, climate change must be an issue. There's nothing that tells me that. It's business as usual. We've got to change that, folks, because we don't have time anymore. So how we do that, of course, becomes a discussion. And I'm not trying to like mix messages or give you a different message. That's not my perspective. This is just my personal perspective of, at some point, we got to change this. So it's great that we all, you know, take out a recycling on Wednesday and, you know, and separate the plastics and the paper. But at some point, we're going to have to get ourselves quickly to non-carbon. Okay. There is good news. I'm not going to go through this in detail, but if you sort of look at each one of these boxes, these eight boxes or so, different sectors of society, all the way from divestment, health, security, the media, James Baylog. If you haven't seen James Baylog Chasing Ice, go see it. It's great. And yes, I have the polar bear because the environmentalists have been talking about this and they have been doing good work for many years. Risky business, Hank Paulson. The religious, more and more religious people. I'm sure Kathleen Hayhoe has probably talked to this group at some point. The Catholics, the Jewish community, the Muslim community. There are many religions now of across the spectrum who realize this is an issue. The insurance guys, the money. And it all kind of comes together. And I think it came together nicely in Paris. That's good. Because then folks who are really not on this train are frankly kind of getting outnumbered. And it's not just one segment of society. And that, I think, is very, very important. what can one person do? You know, and I think you guys probably know this better than me. That was from I gave a talk to this tiny little town in McConnellsburg, Pennsylvania. I literally had to look it up on the map to figure out where I was going. Population about 140. Rural Pennsylvania, which I'll tell you is just about as conservative as rural Texas. It's pretty conservative out there. This is the basement of the library. But, you know, there were 40 people and they just wanted to learn. It was pretty, actually, it was pretty fun. Okay, how do you go viral on the internet? You guys know. Cats, right? I don't have any cats. I have a cute llama instead. I don't have any cute kittens, though. But my llama stands for something. So the first L is learn. You guys already do that. You've heard, you know enough about climate. This does not mean you all become Michael Mann. This means that you just have the basics. And I'll give you two references later on, but my guess is 90% of you guys, you already got that part. The second part, I hear. I look at the Priuses and the Leafs in the parking lot. Local action. Do what you can. Set the example. Do what you can. You know? But if you're farming and you need a pickup, hey, have a pickup. Maybe there's a more fuel-efficient one, but have a pickup. But if you can have an electric car, that's great. I had a choice at State College when I moved up to Penn State. I could have a big place 10 miles out, or I could have a small place and a 15-minute walk from my office. I chose plan B. You know, it's do what you can. M is monitor. This actually came up in one of the breakout groups. We talked about satellites and satellite continuity. Monitor the technical part, because without long-term records, it's really hard to tell what the climate's doing. Monitor can also be monitor your politicians. What are they doing? Not what are they saying, but what are they doing? And then the A is what you do so very well. It's advocacy. The way I frame it, and I know you've got training, so I don't want to, you know, discount any or cross any of that. But I tell people, non-CCL people, just ask any of your leaders, federal, state, local, what are you doing to stabilize the climate? You know, it's not a yes or no question. It's not, are you in favor of X or Y? Because yes or no is, you know, you kind of shut down the conversation. It's sort of like dating 101, right? Ask an open-ended question. What are you doing to stabilize? You might get a lousy answer. But that's okay, because inside that sort of reptilian politician brain, they care. They care what the constituents say. They did not get elected by not knowing who their constituents were. They got there for a reason. And if enough constituents care enough, we are going to lead the Congress. The Congress will not lead, but they can be led. And it's going to be led by you. That's what's going to happen. Okay. Here's the two readings, and I can give you the slides. I can give anybody who wants this a link, or I can send the link to Mark, and he can send it out. The one on the right, What We Know, it's 16 pages. Your moms could read it. Your dads could read it. It's very well written. It's written at a level which is very, very accessible. And that'll get you to about 92 to 95% literacy compared to the rest of the country. If you want to get to 99, you can read the one on the left. It's about 30 pages, and it's a tad more technical. That'll answer any question you ever come up with there. So those two, boom. You don't need to read the whole IPCC. You don't need to read the whole National Climate Assessment. You don't need to be Michael Mann or Catherine Hayhoe. If you have the one on the right, and for extra credit, the one on the left, you've got the information you need, really. Okay, the risk. We talked about risk at the beginning. The risk is not that we are underestimating. The risk is on the right-hand side. As I've mentioned a few times, as scientists, we're kind of conservative. We suffer sometimes from failure of imagination as much as everyone else. The risk is on the right-hand side if we have underestimated the sensitivity and the feedbacks. So let me just close with a story here. Who's from Mississippi? We got a couple, right? We got a couple. Okay. So this is Waveland, Mississippi. I'll bet some of you know. So I'll bet a lot of people here, you've driven I-10, right? Okay. Exit 2. This is exit 2 in Mississippi on I-10. I lived in a place called Waveland, and that's where we actually ran the Navy's Weather and Ocean headquarters, and this was my house. And this is what my house looks like after a 9-meter storm surge comes up the street. So that's me on the right, kind of wondering what to do next. When we say we lost our house, we like literally did lose our house. We have no idea to this day where the house went. It either went up to the street into the railway embankment, or it got sucked out into the Gulf, probably sucked out into the Gulf. The good thing is, the ugliest house on the street was one up from me, so my fantasy is the house came off its foundations, knocked down the ugly house, and that was good. So I don't know. So I put this up not for sympathy points. We had insurance, and we were lucky. We were very, very fortunate relative to many other people. But think of the increasing number of people who this happens to, and they have nothing. And if you have people who have nothing and they become desperate, that ultimately can become a really big security challenge, because they don't have the resources, and now they're very susceptible to a charismatic person and all of that kind of thing. So be careful. Here's just one more, because again, we're down here. So this is Waveland. My lot is the one with a for sale sign. Come see me afterwards if you're interested. The people to the left, that's the exact same elevation that they were before, because they're convinced it's never, never going to happen again. The one to the far left, that's the plumber in the town. Mama didn't raise no fool. He's now up at about 30 feet. But you know, he's on those really thin pylons, and I hate to tell him what's going to happen with the storm surge stuff. This is what happens when you have adaptation without policy. Everybody does their own thing. Okay. All right. Couple quotes. You can read them. You know, I don't think either Admiral Nimitz or who's from Texas, right? Or Secretary Schultz, fellow advisory member on CCL, probably neither of these gentlemen have ever really been accused as being tree huggers, but I would argue, I'm a little hesitant to put words into Admiral Nimitz's mouth, but you can see what he said about looking at risks, and you can see what Secretary Schultz said. These are pretty well-thinking people, and we need to get more people in leadership positions thinking that way. Okay, so this gentleman here is alleged to have said, turns out I don't know anything he said, everybody disputes it, but he says that Americans can always be counted upon to do the right thing after exhausting every other possibility. So he may be doing that, but I said, you know, I don't want to end, I'm in Texas, I can't end on a Brit in Texas. So we got this guy here. You know, and this is kind of a simpler message. You know, life is tough, but it's tougher if you're stupid. So let's stop being stupid, because we know what to do here. So with that, I will end with this. I will say that, you know, when we are engaged, this is my belief. My belief is that when America is engaged, we do absolutely amazing and incredible things. We can do things that nobody else still to this day in the world will do or can do. This, of course, was Apollo 13 out of the movie there. You know, those astronauts should have died, but they didn't, because we were focused, and we figured out things in a very time-compressed manner. The time is running out, but we still have time to do this, and when this country gets engaged and focused, we will do amazing things, and I'm still optimistic we're going to do that, but don't put too much more runway behind us. Thank you very much. Thanks. Please, thanks. Thanks very much. Thank you. Please. Okay. All right. And I probably use stuff all the time. Thanks. Thank you so much. Okay, thanks. Please, thanks. Thanks very much. Thank you. Please.